Up the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board to order. Before we get into the last meeting's agenda, I'd like to welcome Peter Carter as a regular member, who is replacing Judy Lardner. Judy Lardner, and Peter's position as an alternate on the board is being filled by Janet McKay, who ironically would have been the sitting chair now had she not resigned from the board. And we welcome Janet. I'm not sure where she is this evening, but we look forward to her contribution. Janet is also a member of the ZORC Committee, the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, and very actively involved in planning and other matters in town. With that, I'd like to have any comments regarding the minutes of the previous meeting of July 19th, 1994. Are there any comments, corrections?
I move that they be accepted as written.
Okay.
Second.
Let me interrupt just for a minute. I do have a couple. I am not one to get into typos, but I think the information would be clear if they were corrected. On the second page, Alice, on 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth paragraph, 1, 2, 3, fourth line down, float the, then curve outward, and I believe it's float they, then curve outward with respect.
Are we on the same page?
I'm on the back of the first page.
The minor on the same.
Page three, sorry.
I think I'm getting with you. Now, where's it?
The float, that word, the should be they.
Oh.
Did everyone get that? That's on page three, paragraph five, line four, reads straight close to the float, the, then curve, it should be they. On page six, there was a comment regarding Mr. Emery's discussion regarding swimming safety, and 1, 2, 3, on the fourth line down, quote, he said that swimming around boats is a common activity, and he feels it is very important that parents take the primary responsibility. If you would review the tape, I don't believe that's a direct quote, but swimming and boating activities occur together in some cases. Swimming around boats per se is not necessarily either a safe or a common activity, but boating and swimming take place on waterfronts and shorefronts. I'd just like to have that clarified, if you would.
Mm-hmm. How would you suggest it should have been?
Good question.
How about swimming and boating?
Swimming and boating, that's good, is a common activity. Are common activities. In the last paragraph prior to Mrs. Lardner's proposed motion, there is a reference to the issues of future owners of the house, and that is a question as to whether or not the approval could be tied, or the use of the facility could be tied to particular users and future users. That is, that the future users wouldn't have the right to change the design of the structure as such. And I don't know if that comment was incorporated into the motion. It doesn't appear to be. Does anyone recall differently? I think the essence of it is incorporated in the motion, but the specific reference to future users is not.
I guess I don't understand your question. Are you asking it to be a part of the motion?
No, I'm just asking if board members had a sense that that was going to be part of the motion, the issue of future users or future residents of the property.
I don't remember it being a part of the the motion as such. I remember discussing that issue, but I don't remember it at any time coming up in the...
I think it would have been handled, or it's covered under item 5, any change in design, operation, or use of the gangway. item five on the next page. I believe that's where it would have been covered. There's nothing to change there. I just wanted to be sure that I didn't have any different understanding of the motion than anyone else. That's the end of my comments. Do I have a motion? Any other discussion?
Change the motion to read as amended.
Second.
Have a motion's been amended and seconded. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Next item on the agenda is correspondence. We have many items of correspondence in tonight's packet, the first of which is a letter from Connie Fretch, I believe it is, regarding the Jelen application in a response to her letter from the town manager. She raises several concerns regarding the conduct of the planning board chair with respect to inappropriate and editorial comments during the second meeting, I believe, or the non-public hearing, and issues related to a correlation that the chair made between the children's safety and the board's concern about safety and the Jelen application and the middle school application. Additionally, there are comments made with respect to the chair's attitude being less than cordial and condescending, and that other public hearing was denied and the public was still subject to his opinions. And she expresses a concern for more professional conduct in the future. Mike McGovern has responded, I think, very appropriately. And not to leave this issue dangling, what I have done is drafted a two-page letter to the town manager, which is in draft form at this time. I have not had a chance to review it either with the board or with the town manager, so I'll leave it in draft form. I think any time that we receive comment from the public, it's appreciated. I'm not sure that I agree with all of her points, but they are taken and they are responded to in the draft letter. Does every board member have a copy of the draft letter?
No.
No, okay. We'll wait for another meeting if that is an issue. We have a petition, once again, for regarding an application that is yet before the board. It's the subdivision that was proposed, the Rosewood second phase subdivision. And again, we have many signatures from residents of Angel Terrace expressing concern about disruption of their neighborhood and vehicular access. There's a very good response to that from Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, stating that the city of South Portland will be kept informed, that the planning department will be received all information. Again, I want to state very clearly that there is no active application for that project before the board. We haven't seen anything or heard anything for several months now, and there's nothing for us to either act on or do at this point.
Could I ask a question?
I have
a copy of the signed petition in front of me, but it refers to provide access to Pheasant Run Apartments. This is the first I've heard of this. I thought the second part of Rosewood was something else altogether.
Pheasant, as far as I'm aware, Pheasant Run Apartments is a project that was proposed on the site of the current Rosewood development many years ago.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
So in the minds of many residents, they still refer to that land as the Pheasant Run Apartment project.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for the question, Ms. Barker. So I hope that clears up everyone's misunderstanding. There should be no rumor or any understanding that there's an apartment complex proposed for that site. It's single-family affordable housing, some units of which are to be affordable. Next item on the agenda or of correspondence is a letter from Mr. Gregory Powell regarding accessory dwelling unit code review. The board has reviewed, has taken initial review, and we will have that item on our agenda later in the meeting. There's also correspondence to Maureen O'Meara from Mike McGovern, town manager, regarding the accessory units. For the public record, and I would like to put this on a planning board workshop meeting, I think it, in terms of public correspondence, it's very helpful, should any member of the public address the planning board in writing, and do so on a corporate letterhead or professional corporation or partnership letterhead. If they are not acting as an official legal representative of either the abutters or the developer, please either acknowledge that clearly or find some other type of letterhead to use.
I think it most often occurs with attorneys, and I think if we want to perhaps stop that, we just, the town write a letter to that law firm and ask if their attorney is representing, it's unclear to the town of Cape Elizabeth whether they're representing. Bring it, it needs to be brought to the attention of the law firm, I think. They're using law firm.
Okay.
I mean, we see that, I have over the last 6 or 7 years, and occasionally you say, well, is this person representing this group, especially when they CC a long list of people? Are they writing as a concerned citizen or a legal representative or a legal counsel?
It's often stated in the correspondence that they're acting not as a representative to the abutters or the applicant, but as an interested citizen, and yet we still receive the correspondence on a professional letterhead.
It's called legal puffing.
I don't know what the term is for it, but I know the intent. Be that as may, I think we should just discuss that at a workshop and come up with some sort of a consensus about how we want to deal with it, if we have any concerns about it at all, and then take that issue to the town manager as may be appropriate. We have I'm a bit out of order here. We have correspondence from the town manager to Mr. Gregory Powell summarizing the areas of the accessory dwelling unit revisions and how those revisions pertain to various sections of the ordinance, a very well drafted response. I'll ask Maureen O'Mara just to give a brief description of the issues related to the traffic regulations, why those come before us, and a little bit of history, if you would, please.
The traffic regulations is a set of existing regulations before the town that the town operates under, and they were revised recently to reflect some of the construction issues that were going to occur on the school site. And most of the changes in there were regards to giving the police chief and the fire chief authority to make different parking arrangements based on the scene rather than always turning things over for official action by the council in terms of parking and non-parking. It doesn't in any way limit what the council can do, but it does allow a swifter response by the police chief and the fire chief in case of emergency situations.
Great, thank you very much. If anyone's been over at the school property, it's been a lot in the local paper regarding that, and there's certainly a lot going on. Acceptance, the next item on correspondence is a Town of Cape Elizabeth Statement of Policy acceptance of gifts of parcels and easements. The Planning Board reviewed this correspondence some time ago and made recommendations. To be quite honest with you, I don't remember specifically which recommendations were adopted and which weren't. We do have the official and approved gift policy, however, it was approved August 8, 1994.
Can I ask a question?
Mr. Parker.
Maybe others, and maybe this question can't be answered, but there are two different policies, and both of them are labeled approved and adopted August 8, 1994, and there is a difference between them.
I have one.
I have two. They're different.
I remember seeing two, and I just assumed that,
Yes, there's one in the packet this evening.
I had two.
Well, I had two in my packet.
Okay. There was the one that was further up in the packet was the earlier draft, and the one that is at the bottom of the packet should be the final draft. They were both provided to me.
Oh, so which one is the one that's been approved and adopted?
The one at the bottom of the package.
I have them together in my hand.
This one. The one with four.
The one with four bullets at the bottom or
yes,
three?
Four bullets at the bottom.
So this other is
out of date. Yes.
So What does deleterious mean?
Deleterious.
Either that or the other one.
Where are you looking?
The last bullet on the second section.
Negative effect. I assume that's a rhetorical question.
No, I didn't know what it meant. One yes, never mind.
Who decides that that has a deleterious effect?
A negative effect?
Negative effect on the adjacent parcels. Is that an answerable question?
I would assume that the town council does.
Okay, great.
Maureen has added in the package, and I would love to say that I've had an opportunity to read all of these. I certainly haven't. There's many, many articles here, and a particular interest in the very top of the series of articles is wetland mitigation banking, penned by Richard Tinsman. Richard Tinsman, Dick Tinsman, is a past chairman of the Planning Board and the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and certainly a valued citizen of the town of Cape Elizabeth, and has written an excellent article on wetland banking. It's a very interesting program and process. It's very early on, infancy in its use. I know that some of that has been used by the DEP in terms of some of the shopping center development, where wetlands in growth areas have been disturbed, and land has, and the mitigation of the disturbance has been made elsewhere. It can, like much public policy today, can get toward the trading of emissions credits, but it certainly has very many applications, particularly in a state like Maine, which is either ledge now or wetland and little in between. I would like to say that we should have an exam at one of our workshops on all of these correspondence, but I believe that it would be appropriate to bring this correspondence to our next workshop and go through it in general terms, particularly for some of the more practical applications under municipal law alert and other issues, signage, anything that is affecting the ordinances that we're reviewing and drafting. There's a wetlands, federal wetland reform article. There's a municipal law alert regarding sign ordinances. I think people by now are getting the general trend in planning law and case law changes. The Dolan case is the next one. Community noise, dealing with a growing problem. Community noise is the reason that I moved back to Maine. Certainly is a real issue. planning consultants, I could offer some insights into that, and there are many other articles within that. Let's see, where are we here? Notice of the Zork Committee workshop. The Zork Committee had a meeting week before last, and the chair of the Zork Committee and I attended just for informational purposes. He made a presentation on the recommendations made by the Zork Committee, made by the LERP Committee for incorporation of the Zork Committee's work. I think for any planning board member who's interested in the use of the ordinances and the content of the ordinances, attending this meeting could be an opportunity to provide some input and insight into the rewrite process. As I said earlier, Janet McKay will be sitting on this committee, as is Maureen O'Meara, and look for very valuable input during that process. The next item is a sewer summit meeting notice. Again, this is to the Town Council Sewer Ordinance Advisory Committee and the Planning Board. This meeting date is Thursday, September 29th. As far as I know, I don't have any conflicts and certainly intend to attend that meeting. Anybody else, any other members of the Planning Board who would wish to do so are more than welcome. And also attached to this and related to this is the Planning Board's correspondence to Bill Jordan, Chairman of the Town Council, regarding our comments that were requested by the Council regarding growth areas. There's 2.5 pages of a letter signed by the chairman of the Planning Board for the Planning Board. There's some very valuable comments there, and I see that some of these are discussed during the summit meeting. Let's see, we had an item under new business, the Dolby Public Access waiver. That application was withdrawn, and I understand will be on the October 18th regular meeting of the planning board. Under other business, we have the town center zone. The planning board has been working many months developing zoning that came out of the town center plan provided by the, prepared by the town center committee. And what I'd like to do is take a minute and have Maureen just provide an overview for the public's benefit as to the general areas of the town center zone, and to give an introduction as to what action is needed to be taken this evening.
The ordinance you have before you is basically what you've been reviewing for the past several months, with the exception that I've made some changes based on your last meeting. The one comment I want to point out is that in reviewing this ordinance text, you're not only talking about changing the text of the zoning ordinance, you're also talking about changing the zoning map to create a town center zone in this part of town. So, and I did not include that in the motion, so anyone who does choose to make some motion should refer to changes to the zoning map as well as changes to the zoning ordinance. Just to go through, there were some suggestions at the last meeting, and what I will do is I'll point out some of the changes, and please stop me if you have any questions. There was a suggestion made to combine the professional office and business office definitions, and that was done on page one, on the second half of page one. On page two, there was a concern under subparagraph B that there was some repetition in the description of what generated site plan review. Keep in mind that the permitted uses list is intended to be a pyramid structure, so that if you're at the top of the pyramid and you move down, you're required to get more review from the planning board. If you're near the middle of the pyramid and you move up, and you've already gotten some kind of planning board review, then you wouldn't need to go back to the planning board. And what this did is I just made the change so it wasn't as repetitive. The other changes, the major change was some of the design standards that the board has been incorporating in here. I pasted in everything that we have so far, and I had a conversation with John Mitchell, who has agreed to supplement what we have in here with a few additional illustrations. What I specifically did, and if you can go to, let's see, page eight, starting on page 10, there was a request made to take the standard that talked about front setback and the standard that talked about buffering and include those together in one standard called landscaping and site development, and that's been broken up into three parts now. The first part is just called a front setback, and I have taken the illustrations that dealt with the front setback from the building to the street, and on the second page what John has called the front setback character illustrations, which are not plan views, let's put it that way. The second section is parking lot, and this is the newest section that you haven't spent as much time on, and that was designed to specifically talk about how a parking lot should be designed in terms of landscaping between the parking lot and the street, and landscaping inside the parking lot. And Mr. Mitchell has agreed to do an additional illustration for us that looks at what a typical parking lot would look like with appropriate landscaping on the interior of it, specifically landscape islands and street trees. And then the third section, which is on page 13, is specifically called buffering, and that would talk about the plantings that are required to buffer adjacent uses, and that the plantings would become more significant, more dense, depending on how compatible or incompatible the adjacent uses are. And Mr. Mitchell has also agreed to do some illustrations for us to show how those plantings can vary based on compatible and incompatible uses. And then finally on page 14, there is no change to this paragraph. It's just the request that was made to revise the existing building permits text section that would not allow for a demolition of a locally historic structure that has been designated in the town center plan unless notice had been given at least 30 days in advance. So unless there are any specific questions, I'm finished.
Any comments, discussion, questions?
One.
Mr. Parkhurst.
Page two, permitted uses under number seven, gas station repair garages. I can't remember what we came to a final consensus on at workshop, but our canopies are not addressed in this. And it seemed like it would be an opportune time to possibly put some language in there to prevent any more canopies from being built in the town.
That's a policy.
Does anyone remember what we discussed?
I believe you discussed it, and there was a decision not to include anything in here about it. I think what was discussed is rather to control the number, the size of a gas station by controlling the number of pumps that any station could have.
Okay, page three, number 10. This is just a question on semantics. I know what cottage industry manufacturing is, but is that limiting enough to prevent something more than what we're trying to limit it to from being started? I'm just wondering if that definition is clear enough so there won't be any ambiguity about it.
Is cottage industry part of the definition?
It's not part of the definition section.
I would either suggest that we add it or use one that is already in.
I think that takes care of what I had to ask.
Any other questions or comments? Any concerns regarding the canopies? Okay, again, just a reminder, the process is that this would go to a public hearing for the opportunity for public input. This board certainly, although we've worked at length in developing these ordinances, more than welcomes public input and encourages public input, particularly in the zoning rewrite process. I implore the public not to feel that, although we've spent months on this, that it's too late for input. If there are concerns about canopies, any other concerns, those comments are welcome either in writing or by attending the public hearing. Do I hear a motion?
Question before a motion is made. And not to contradict what you just said, but my question has to do with procedures. Is there a requirement that the planning board hold a public hearing on this item? My understanding is that subsequent to, if we have a public hearing, then the council is then required to hold a public hearing. I'm not sure that's a requirement that the planning board hold one.
That's correct. The procedure for amending the ordinance is that the council cannot act on any zoning ordinance amendment without sending it to the planning board and allowing you at least a minimum, I think, of 45 days to comment. At that point, you have the option of holding a public hearing, but you're not required to. Then you make a recommendation back to the council, and the council is required to hold a public hearing. So that is part of your decision tonight. You can choose not to hold a public hearing.
I know that it flies in the face of what the board tries to do as far as opening up for public comment, but there's also a question of time and getting it before the council. And if we simply, there are times when we don't have a lot of public comment at our meetings, and just the reality of the fact, is it more prudent to simply send it on to the town council where they're required to have a public hearing?
But if we had a public hearing, wouldn't it possibly give the public a little bit more chance for input prior to going to the council? And then we could revise what we do send to the council?
Maybe we can discuss the issue of public hearing as part of the motion. I think it's a very valid question, because there hasn't been a lot of input, but...
I have a motion for the board to consider.
Mr. Edsall?
Be it ordered that, based on the proposed text changes and the facts presented, the proposed town center zone zoning ordinance amendment be tabled to the regular October 18th, 1994, meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Don't we need to amend that to include in zoning map amendment?
In zoning what?
In zoning map amendment.
Just a minute, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Let it fail.
Hmm?
Just let it fail due to lack of second.
No second. Does anyone wish to amend?
Okay, just to amend that, to read, be it ordered that, based on the proposed text changes and the facts presented, the proposed town center zoning ordinance amendment and zoning map amendment be tabled to the regular October 18th, 1994 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
We have a motion. There's a second.
Second.
Any discussion on the motion and second? Any questions regarding the public hearing? In the issue of customer service, certainly this item gets to the council more quickly if we don't hold a public hearing. The track record has been that while holding public hearings on zoning ordinance issues, there often is not much public input because it's such an area of detail. However, since this is the town center zone, since there was a town center study zoning committee, there were two public hearings during that process, I think that it's very appropriate to have an opportunity for the public to come before the planning board and offer comments concerning the town center zone. Any other comments or questions? Okay, we have a motion and second. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Motion passes unanimously. Next item under other business in this evening's agenda is the accessory dwelling unit amendments. Maureen, you could give us a little background on this package.
Certainly. The accessory dwelling unit amendments were originally drafted by the ordinance committee. The ordinance currently has a set of amendments. It has a provision in there right now that allows people with a minimum house size of 2,500 square feet to convert a portion of their house into an apartment, which size shall be not less than 900 square feet. In looking at this amendment, there was concern by the ordinance committee that what was originally the purpose of this amendment was no longer what they wanted to do. The intent now is to allow people who would like to create a, for the most part, an independent living experience for an elderly relative within their home. Some of the requirements in the current ordinance don't allow people to do that. They also force people into making changes to their home that may not be consistent with a single family character. So the current provisions would allow people to add an accessory dwelling unit to an existing single family home of at least 1,500 square feet. But the minimum, the maximum size of the accessory unit is no larger than 600 square feet. And that was deliberately made very small because there is an intent here to really create an accessory unit that does not overwhelm the single family structure. This amendment is supported by findings of both the Affordable Housing Committee in their report and in the comprehensive plan as a way to create affordable housing in the town through the provision of accessory dwelling units.
And are there revisions since our last workshop meeting?
The revisions since the last workshop meeting are, one, You had specifically requested me to put in the purpose statement that this is intended to provide affordable housing, and that's been put in there. There was a request that, there was another request just to make the purpose statement clearer, because there was a lot of talk about new homes versus existing homes, and what, which ones would be allowed to add accessory dwelling units, which, by the way, both would be allowed to. And that, I made an attempt to make that clearer. There was a concern that restricting homes from counting new additions to their square footage requirement was inconsistent with allowing people with new homes to build accessory dwelling units within the home. Therefore, that restriction was eliminated. You add an addition, and 6 months later, you want to count that addition towards your accessory, towards your total square footage size to make you qualify for an accessory dwelling unit. You can do that. The third condition, I'm trying to remember because I don't have my copy with me. There is in the existing ordinance provision some language about what you have to do if you're complying with the sewer ordinance and what you have to do if you have a subsurface disposal system. That whole section has been eliminated because it duplicates what's already in the sewer ordinance, and in some cases, it's inconsistent with the intent of allowing less lot area if you are connected to sewer. So there's just been a straight reference to the sewer ordinance, and the sewer ordinance would govern regardless, so there's no need to put it in this section. There was another change in here that talked about single-family front yard and front door, and you wanted to make it very clear that any additional doors that might go to the accessory dwelling unit would not detract from the front door, so there was another line put in there about that. You also requested that the limitation on not allowing the parking space to be stacked be eliminated. So the line that required that the new parking space that would have to be created for the accessory dwelling unit would have to have direct access from the road, that no longer is a requirement. And I believe that's all the changes.
Okay, any comments, questions, or discussion?
Someone else want to go first?
Mr. Parkhurst?
Okay. I think everyone knows from the workshop sessions how I feel about this particular issue. And I guess I am not in favor of it, but I think it seems that we're going to be stuck with it somehow. So I guess I would like to limit this with some kind of mechanism that if a property changes hands, then the permit for the second apartment be automatically pulled from that property, and the people have to remove the second kitchen unless they come in and can demonstrate that they are living there and that they actually have a need for the accessory unit. And it seems to me if they're able to just buy the property, they probably can't unless they're planning on the income from that apartment to help them afford the home. I think the intent of all this was to provide housing for some member of the family for one need or another. They needed to be closer to either, children or something. There's got to be some mechanism. The feedback I've heard from people is they're somewhat aghast that this is going to be allowed to happen in this town. I too feel the same way. I don't think it's right unless there is truly a family member that needs to be taken care of for one reason or another. And I would suggest that mechanism I just described, that if the property is sold, then that permit for that accessory unit be, not sure what the word is, extinguished, and they would have to remove in a very short period of time that second kitchen unit. I know it's not going to prevent people from popping it back in, but at least we have the law on our side to enforce something. And we've talked about in a workshop session that there are a number of these illegal accessory units in the town already. And it just seems to me that if we do this and make a big thing about it, we're going to have a lot more, and it's going to upset a lot of people. And it is truly going to affect people's property values that are adjacent to these properties. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. especially if the apartments are rented out to non-members of the family, you know, to college students or whomever. I'm not trying to pick on anyone at all, but if they're rented out, it's going to have a detrimental effect on real estate values and the single-family nature of any neighborhood.
Does anybody else have any response to Steve's concern? We have a couple of options this evening. We have a motion in front of us. We can sit and deliberate. We have a fairly open agenda tonight, a very open agenda. We can deliberate any amendments to what we've drafted so far if we wish to do so, and include that in tonight's motion. Or, for example, with what Steve has just suggested, there seem to be very significant legal implications as to what he's suggesting. That is that a building permit is offered as part of this process, and then when one goes to sell the house, there's, in essence, would be no permit to be withdrawn.
Or the occupancy permit would be withdrawn or something. I'm not quite sure what the mechanism would be.
Mr. Edsel?
Yeah, I don't have the legal answers is what, how that would operatively in the law, you rescind or take away that interest in the in or that right in the property. I'm sure that it can be, well, I'm not sure, I would think that it could be designed that approval is for current owner. How you rate only, in other words, when I think you can regulate that when the property is transferred. When somebody moves, is it you're saying when somebody moves out or the ownership changes of the, in the property?
Well, I'm not really sure if we can, it's hard to know if someone moves out. I mean, the tax bill theoretically is still going to come to the address or it's still going to be the same name. So it's hard to find out that they've actually moved out unless you just happen to hear that. But if the property being sold, I mean, the town hall is, upon closing, I think they're fairly promptly notified that the property has changed hands because they have to send a tax bill to someone else. And that would be the most expedient and probably quickest way to find out that the property has changed hands and that then the owners are no longer living there. Mm-hmm. It's a new set of owners.
Can I, operatively, I don't know how you prevent that to accrue to a new owner. Well, I would assume that it could be done.
Well, could the occupancy permit be tied to the life of ownership, not the life, but the duration of ownership of the person whose permit name the permit was taken out in? Yeah, otherwise, the
it's like a life estate of conditional use.
Excuse me?
It's like a life estate of conditional mm-hmm. use, but I don't know how it operatively works in law.
I mean, you can then see someone buying a piece of property that say it had a 1500 square foot or 2000 square foot, just to make it easy, main house and had a 600 square foot accessory unit, they could buy the property based on renting out the larger of the two, move into the smaller of the two, and I just think it would have a very negative effect on neighbors and property values.
Two things to address Mr. Parker's comments, Mr. Chair. We can choose to delay this or table this for one more month to see if there is indeed public comment to the negative, which we've read some, would also open it up to more public comment to see, just to get some feedback. Either at that time or at this time, without forwarding it for or tabling it for public hearing, I think the board has two or three different options. We can approve the draft, the amended draft, and forward with no recommendation for approval to the council. We can approve it, the draft, with a recommendation for no approval, or we can simply approve the draft. And we don't typically give recommendation, or do it in the verbiage. I would defer to the planner. When we respond to the council, how does that usually?
Usually you make a recommendation of some sort, and yeah. Typically I mean, the recommendation is.
Mark our disapproval of this, if that's a consensus of the board, which I've concurred. I'm not sure that I'm not in agreement that I even like the tone of the ordinance. So, you know, it's like saying, here's a changed draft, but we don't recommend it, versus we recommend it not be approved, or we simply wait for more public comment.
Maureen, what I sense here, and I believe is really an issue, is that if the planning board makes no, does not make a positive recommendation to the council of the draft that's been sent us, there are several options that follow. One is that the suggested amendments sent to us would be adopted by the council as is. It could also be that there are no changes to the ordinance and a provision for accessory units still would exist within the ordinance under the old criteria, which I don't have in front of me, but are much more restrictive than the ones that are before the planning board at this time. And just parenthetically, in the board's discussion and deliberation of the proposed draft, we looked at it from, I think, three key points. One is that it, in a very subtle way, has a major effect on the notion of single-family zoning in the town of Cape Elizabeth, because in essence it allows accessory units or apartments within the single-family zone. Secondly, if indeed it is to meet the requirement or the policy statement in the comprehensive plan of providing more affordable housing within Cape Elizabeth, although the thresholds for allowing an accessory unit have been significantly lowered, the lot area is smaller and the unit sizes are smaller, and the overall house size, square footage is smaller, it still is, could be argued that the 15,000 square foot lot size could be either 10 or 12,000 or some other number, and the board has discussed that at some length. So on the one hand, we have concern about destruction of the single family zone. We have concern that if the goal is to make units affordable, we still may not be there yet. It may be that even smaller lots can make better use of this provision. Thirdly, the board could recommend that we don't amend this at all, and perhaps even further suggest that the existing accessory unit ordinance be looked at for its impact in the town zoning, and that if the desire is to have affordable units within the town zone, the zoning state forthright create a zone where that's recommended, either the town center or other zones in town. I guess what I would like to hear and from the board in terms of discussion is whether or not you feel comfortable this evening. A concern I have is that we go ahead and put this on a public hearing agenda and get comments from the public hearing and then come back and with a whole new ordinance from what the public heard. If we're going to change this drastically, I would like to do it in a workshop session before the public hearing rather than set forth to the public what is a fairly concisely constructed set of standards, and then come back with a whole new approach. Does the board have any preference one way or the other on that matter?
Could I just offer something else up here that I've done in workshop? I would like to make it part of the record before I react to what you just said. Mm-hmm. In the comprehensive plan, in the questionnaire in the back of the booklet, there is a section on housing, and there are three questions that are applicable here. Number 11, the town's zoning regulation should allow new apartments and condominiums in any neighborhood as long as they are well designed. Strongly agree, 4%, agree, 9%, disagree, 31%, strongly disagree, 55%. So clearly 86% of the people that responded to this questionnaire don't think that's appropriate. Number 13, the construction of new apartment buildings should be prohibited in existing residential neighborhoods that are mostly single-family homes. Strongly agree, 56% agree, 29%. That's 85% do not want, disagree, 9%, strongly disagree, 5%, and no opinion, 2%. And in your opinion, should the town, and B, have more multifamily housing, in parentheses, apartments. Yes, 14%, no, 79%, no opinion, 7%. Let me flip to question number 35, of the, again, of the respondents. Do you own or rent your living quarters? 95% own, 5% rent. That tells me something pretty strongly, and you mentioned the affordable housing issue. By creating these, supposedly, I thought they were going to be accessory units that were intended for family members, affordable housing then connotes the fact that they're going to be paying rent.
I assume they could do either. They could either pay a rent stipend or live there as an invited guest of the
right.
family.
I understand that, but the affordable housing tag on it indicates that there is some price tag on it of one kind or another. As to your other question, I would rather take this back to workshop, given you know what I've said tonight, and see if we can get, if I can win any of you over to my way of thinking, and amend this thing before we send it to the council.
Amanda, I'm not worried about sending it to the council yet. We haven't got to the point of a public hearing.
Well, even before we get the public hearing.
Again, this is a matter of that could be easily overlooked by the public. It's any ordinance rewrite is easily overlooked. It's very technical, and sometimes the titles don't really indicate how important the information is. I guess at this point, what I'd like to do, we've had discussion. Are there any other comments?
Just a brief comment,
Mr. Edsel.
Chair. I can't honestly remember how we left the issue of and why it still stands at 15,000 square feet. Was it a case that we didn't like the ordinance anyway, and so we'd leave it as it was written, or was there consensus on the board that it should remain at 15,000 square feet?
Consensus would be the right word. It wouldn't be 100% agreement or vote. My recollection is, unless if anyone else recalls differently, is that we discussed it and that it had been lowered significantly from the previous standard, and we felt that to go lower would be a real test of the council. But perhaps in either sketch form or in other recommendations to the council, we could demonstrate that whether it's whatever the threshold is, 10, 12, 15,000 square feet, once one gets to smaller lots, the impacts are not significant. If one follows the other recommendations of the ordinance. Does anyone help?
I guess my gut feeling about this is that if the intent is to change the definition of single family ownership as such, and there's a need for multifamily dwelling units in Cape Elizabeth, which I've been an advocate for in the past, and I don't think that this is the right way of going about it, and that's just my gut feeling. I don't think that it acts in the way that we may have to deal with larger structures in the next decade. I think it can be problematic. I guess it's my own opinion. I would, if we decide to forward this to the council, if it's the wishes of the board to forward it, with any type of recommendation, I'd like to hear more public comment. We've had this in public workshop sessions. If there is a strong public comment about accessory dwelling units, I think I'd like to at least open it up for that. With whatever publicity we can provide, we've tried it before, and very seldom do we get much turnout. But I think if we can at least notify people through the Cape Courier that the accessory dwelling unit ordinance is an ordinance stating thus, public comments invited at a public hearing, da-da-da-da. If we hear nothing, I think this one board member would simply say, here's an amended draft forward with no recommendation to the council.
Mr. Wilcox?
I agree with what Stephen has been saying, and I have a question that perhaps Maureen could help us with a little bit, because one thing that I'm kind of confused about is determination of impacts of policies on adjacent properties or adjacent zones is quite frequently not a planning board issue, but a zoning board issue. Why, perhaps, are they going to be having review of this also, or are we the only town board that will be reviewing?
The planning board gets to review this because the zoning ordinance amendment process requires that any amendment to the zoning ordinance has to come by you first. That's the only reason you get to see this. When the ordinance committee was drafting this, however, Larry Clough, who was the immediate past chair of the ordinance committee, of the zoning board, was very kind enough to attend almost every meeting and had an extensive amount of comment on this ordinance. I'm not saying he supports it. I'm saying he had a lot of comment. I would hope that before the council considered adoption, that they would also forward it to the zoning board for their comment. But I'm not really sure that that's not the response. Quite honestly, that's not the responsibility of this board. You were forwarded this ordinance. You were asked to respond by November 1st.
Yeah, I think one of the reasons that, as a board member, I agree with what Stephen just said is I almost feel that responsibility for establishing what, in effect, would be a major zone change for the town, as well as determining issues such as adjacent property values, is somewhat outside of the scope of our normal reviews. And everything that we've done to date in workshop concerning size of parcels, addressing physical impacts on structures within neighborhoods, I think we've been addressing the things that we are charged with addressing on a week-to-week basis, and I feel fairly comfortable with those. But the global issue of multifamily versus single family, I think, is something that other people need to take more of a leadership role in determining.
Thank you, Mark. Peter?
I feel before the planning board attempts to rewrite this amendment in workshop that we should schedule the public hearing and move the matter to a public hearing front, therefore rewriting it only once rather than twice after the public hearing. I think on this particular issue, we will see attendance at the public hearing and we will hear comments from the public because it is a townwide zoning change.
There's two ways to consider this public hearing. One would be a hearing that would comment on the recommended changes from the planning board to the council, and specifically to comment on those. The other way of thinking of it is preliminary public input into the process. I think what I'm hearing this evening is, although we've taken the proposed amendments from the council and revised them and added comments, the board as a whole doesn't feel committed to the entire notion of this zoning amendment, and therefore could benefit from public input during the workshop session, so to speak. I guess the question I would have for Maureen, what I don't see happening clearly here, is that we have a public hearing next week. The suggestion I heard earlier was not to put on our proposed amendments, but to take the draft that was given us from the council, advertise that in the paper to alert people to the process, to have them come in and provide their concerns and comments with regard to the proposed amendments from the council, based on public input and based on further deliberation at the workshop following the public hearing. We would come up with our final draft to come back to a regular meeting of the planning board. At that time, it would seem that we would either forward that, table that for a public hearing. Is that correct? That we would have to take the amended ordinance back to a regular meeting of the planning board and then table it for a public hearing? Or could we take it from a workshop meeting and provide public notice and have the final approval and recommendations at the second public hearing?
Like the previous amendment, you're not required to hold a public hearing on this item. You could take the recommendations of the council and forward them to the council without holding a public hearing. I assume the board would want to do some kind of opportunity for the public to speak, since we've had some written comments from members of the public. Mr. Goldman's been in to see me on a regular basis and has expressed commitment to coming to any public hearing the board is going to schedule.
Okay, I guess in summary, what we would do is, although it's not our typical process in looking at zoning amendments, but we would, what we could do is table this evening for our next workshop, I'm sorry, we'd table it for the next public hearing, and the notice that would go in the paper would include the original draft from the council, not any proposed revisions that we've drafted so far in workshop, and those revisions stand, I guess, very shaky at this point. Yes, Mr. Carlson?
Mr. Chair, I have just one question, and maybe Maureen can help us out. The creation of accessory dwelling unit, the purpose of this provision, it mentions number of affordable housing units, which in my mind promotes the development of apartments or income-producing units. If we were just to say the purpose of this provision is to permit the creation of an accessory dwelling unit with an existing single-family unit, would that suffice?
In terms of...
I'm just trying to look ahead, where when we say affordable housing, a lot of people get a certain connotation about that as being something that very low-rent housing or whatever it might be. So I just mention that.
Yeah, reading from the June 28th draft of this ordinance, under that section, it read creation of accessory dwelling unit. The purpose of this provision shall be to permit the creation of accessory dwelling unit within a new or existing single-family dwelling that is consistent with the character of the single-family dwelling. The affordable housing part was added after the last planning board workshop.
Yeah.
So if you put it in, you can take it out.
Thank you.
Okay, I think at this point, do you have any other comments, Roy?
No, thank you.
Okay. At this point, if there's no further discussion, I'd like to get off the nickel here perhaps with a motion, and we can resolve it through discussions of the motion. Do I have a motion? Mr. Parkhurst?
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the proposed text changes and the facts presented, the proposed accessory dwelling unit text revisions be tabled to the regular October 18th, 1994 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
I'll second the motion.
We have a second. Any discussion on the motion and second? Mr. Edson?
The only comment that I have is reference to your comment, the advertising in its original form, and I guess we can talk about this after a vote, but I'm not sure that without showing changes that have been made, gives the public the true picture of some of the changes and kind of the board's work. I think part of what we're faced with is that because we've looked at this over the last few months, a lot of what is knowledge to us is not inherently obvious to general public. They may not recognize it. The effect of this ordinance means this, and that I don't know how to publicize that without saying specifically that this ordinance can change the definition of single-family ownership in the zone areas, the residential zoned areas of the town.
Thank you. Any other discussion on the motion?
Well, not so much the motion, but just when it is publicized, if it can be given somewhat prominent placement in the Cape Courier or the Portland newspaper or something, so people do actually see it and realize it's going to happen on October 18th.
Do my best.
I think we can then, at that time, sort of outline what's going on, and people, I think, we'll probably call Maureen once it goes in the paper and ask her what's going on. She'll answer a lot of questions.
Mm-hmm. Maureen, you had a comment?
I think for the purpose of this procedure, the best thing would be for the board to agree on one version that at least for discussion purposes is going to public hearing, It doesn't mean that people can't come and look at my file and see all the different versions that have been generated, but are we talking about the version you have in front of you this evening, or are we talking about the original recommendation from the town council that's going to public hearing?
Precisely, thank you. Mr. Wilcox?
I feel that with respect to the planning issues that we've been presented with, that the version that we have here is improved over what we were presented with. We have not as yet modified the basic premise of the ordinance, but I think we've done some good work on improving it, and I think that that's what should be reviewed at this point.
I agree.
I agree, too. I think this is an unusual, it's very difficult, because at the same time, one wants public input, the public also wants to know where we're headed with this, and I think this is where we've gotten to this point, and we are very eager to get public input through the process. Okay, so it's understood that the version that will be presented, provided to the public, is the amended draft to date, with none of the comments or questions that were raised this evening. Okay. We have a motion that's been seconded. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. It passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Again, we really encourage public participation in this matter. That's the last item on this evening's agenda. Are there any other items for discussion or issues? Seeing Mr. Edsel?
I move that we adjourn.
Okay, we have a motion.
Seconded.
All those in favor, please indicate. Meeting is adjourned. Thank you.